things that I know of. Hello, man, y'all got real quiet. Music was playing, y'all were talking, this, that, and other. Then all of a sudden, the music stopped. He said, well, we must be getting ready to start. Now, well, I look up there, and it's 10:59. So, I don't know, I have to check my phone. Because your clock may be going backwards. No, it's 11 o'clock, right on the dot. Straight up and down.
Alrighty. You say, well, what's that? Well, it's somebody that we need to pray for right here. Alrighty. Is that last name, Danny, is that Hall?
Hoyt Hall.
Okay. Well, we need to say special prayer today for Hoyt Hall. The body's failing in kidneys and heart and lungs. And they're in St. Thomas there, west of Nashville. We need to lift them up in prayer this morning and ask God to touch them. And you pray for our nation, amen. Pray one for another. If you got to come the other night, you had a wonderful time. At least I hope and pray you did. I ain't heard anybody say yet that they didn't like it. I think anybody leave hungry? I know I didn't either. Man, I think I left Brother Lonnie with a few extra pounds, like about 5 or 10. You know, that's what kind of happens when you do a spread like that, you know. But it was good. The movie was good. It was good fellowship. I enjoyed it, and I hope and pray you did too. And we're looking forward to doing some more things. Matter of fact, I got some things to share with you here in a few moments. But we'll go ahead and get started this morning. How many of y'all glad that God still sits on the throne?
Amen.
Well, I know I am too. The Bible says in Psalms chapter 46, God is our refuge and strength and a very present help in trouble. Can you think of anybody better, anybody greater than the Lord that we can go to? There isn't. There is none better. And I'm here to tell you, He takes care of us. What a great God we serve. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, as we come to the throne, we thank you for the privilege. Help us, guide us, direct us, be with us. And Lord, just continue to let us be a light in this difficult time in which we're finding ourselves in. I pray, Lord, that you'll take and heal our land. Be with our officials. Be with the president. Be with all these things that's going on in our world today. And I pray, Lord, that you'll just guide and direct us through it. We look forward to the day that we'll see you. But until then, help us to contend until you come. Thank you for this opportunity, dear Lord. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Good morning. If you are a visitor here at Faith Baptist Church this morning, if you would, look right in front of the pew and pick up that piece of paper, please. If you would, fill that out and put that in the offering plate, we'd sure appreciate it. And also, I'm going to have to apologize to the preacher, because I'll tell you what, I got a nephew that owns a pizza place, and you did a whole lot better job than they did. So that's all I'm going to say, and if he's watching and he hears that, sorry about your luck, Chris. But y'all that got to eat the pizza, you know how good it was. But now there was a lot more hands in there helping than just him.
Amen. Amen.
But you've got to have a leader. Now there's two things that a leader does. He stands back, keeps his hands in his pocket, and stands and watches everybody else. Go use the telephone 2 or 3 times. That way you get out of the way. You did a superb job.
Did my part well, did I?
And he's got a new name, which is Puffin' Fresh, in case y'all seen that on the videos, right? And he's got a friend of his that'll probably have to apologize to.
You know, when you listen to certain people, Brother John, and they give you certain directions, be careful.
Amen.
Because they may lead you right off the cliff. Just kind of want to throw it out there. And Mickey, I just kind of want to throw it out there. Amen.
So if y'all would, please stand with me and send the light. Amen. Page 3.
Amen. 74.
There's a call that comes ringing o'er the restless waves. Send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue. There are souls to save. Send the light. Send the light. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light. Blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And a golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Amen. Father, we love you. Glorify thy name. Father, we love you, we worship and adore you, glorify thy name in all the earth, glorify thy name, glorify.
Circumstance and situation we find ourselves in, isn't it good that we have a God that cares, loves us beyond all measure? It truly is. And as we do go forward, we want to glorify him. We do want to praise him because of what he's given to us, what he's done for us, and who he is to us. Amen. And what a great God that we serve. I do want to give you a few things that we're kind of pondering on. Matter of fact, some of y'all might have already seen, some of y'all might have already signed up, but we're going to do our Valentine banquet this year by going out. What that means is, my daddy always used to say it like this. He says, when I go to eat, we all go to eat. When I go to pay, we all go to pay. Amen. Y'all know what that means?
Sure enough. Everybody take care of their own is what that basically means. But anyways, so we're going to go out. I should know, and the reason I say should know, during this time frame that we're finding ourselves in, it's awful difficult to line up a restaurant. But we got a couple that are on the radar screen that we're talking with and everything, and I'll let you know and as quick as I can. We won't know until Monday. That's why I say as quick as I can. But rather it's going to be Friday night or Saturday night. Friday night's the 12th. Saturday night's the 13th. So Friday night or Saturday night, when we'll be able to get in there and have our reservations. But anyways, but there's two restaurants that we have narrowed it down to. And so we'll see which one that will suit us best. And we'll be able to get in there that night and have a good time of fellowship. But we'll do that on the 12th or the 13th. And I say the 12th or the 13th, just kind of circle both dates right there, because we're trying to find out how we can kind of work that out. And I'll have to let you know starting Wednesday night the exact time and everything when we can actually get in there. But you know, they've already said that they can seat where it looks like if we have a pretty good turnout, pretty good crowd and everything. They said they have enough space where they can seat us and have enough to feed us. You know, it's one thing to get sat down. It's another thing to get fed. So amen right there. So you definitely want that. But looking forward to that, and that'll be on the 12th and the or the 13th. And so circle those two things. And if you are going, please be sure and sign the paper out there, because that gives us a heads up about how many of us are going. Amen. And so we can kind of let the restaurant know about how big our group's going to be. And so we'll do that on that time. Now, also, at the last of the month, last Tuesday of the month, we're going to go back over and put Bibles together. Looking forward to doing that. But I got another thing to throw on the table. Next Sunday night after the service, we're going to go back into the back again. And we're going to enjoy that big screen that we got fixed up back there again. We're going to put on a thing called the Habinger. The Habinger is a documentary about the end times, dealing with where we're at and kind of where America's in the crosshairs there. And so we'll be showing that on that Sunday night after the service. Now, what that means is, on that Sunday night, which is next Sunday night, not this Sunday night, but next Sunday night, we'll show the Habinger. What that basically means is we need little finger foods. Amen. So everybody kind of bring those little finger foods, those little snack stuff. You know, I don't know about you, but we'll pop some corn again. We'll put some more popcorn in the popcorn maker. But I like those little things like piggies in the blanket and things like that, you know. So we'll just try to do that. And that's for anybody that wants to stay over next Sunday night after the service. Stick around. Or if you want to come to the Sunday night service, then stick around. And we're going to show that in the back on our big screen. How many of y'all enjoyed that the other night with that big screen? And, you know, and I promise you, me and Brother John, we're talking about, we're going to even get our sound system to do even better than it did. Some of y'all said, well, it worked for me, preacher. It sounded pretty good. We're going to make it better, ain't we, Brother John? But it was good. The movie the other night was very good. How many of y'all liked that little twist on the tail end of it? Amen. What that basically means is, when it happens, ain't going to be no time to be changing your mind. Amen. I'm telling you, it's coming fast. And when the Lord's return comes and everything, ain't going to be no time to make it up. It's going to be then. That's why today's the day of salvation. Now's the accepted time. Amen. And so we thank God for these opportunities we have to serve Him, to honor Him, and to come together as a body of believers. Now, with all that being said, I'm glad I have a God that cares, that loves beyond all measure. So we're going to go, Lord, in prayer right now. Danny, if you will lead us in prayer over the offering, pray for the church, pray for our nation, but also pray for Mr. Hall right here, okay? If you'll do that and lift him up in prayer. Thank you. years of time alone, but for eternity. Amen. If you got your Bibles with you, go with me to the book of Acts in chapter number 20 this morning. Acts in chapter number 20. I had a guy tell me one time. What do you mean, skin in the game? He said, well, he said, when somebody has skin in the game, Brother Shane, he says that means that they're connected. They got something invested into what they're doing. He said, if you ain't got skin in the game, it don't mean as much to you. Matter of fact, you can come and go any which way that you want to. And I started pondering that and thinking about that, and he's exactly right. Skin in the game does mean quite a bit difference than just somebody showing up. And maybe this morning you might want to ask yourself this question, do I have any skin in the game? What does it really mean to me? Are we just going through the motions? If the doors were shut, would it really matter? Well, I got news for you. I got skin in the game. This place matters to me.
Rather not these doors stay open,
it matters to me. These lights staying on, it matters to me. I'm supposed to be. You tell me I'm not? You know what that means? It means we got us a dead battery. Sure enough. Y'all thought Jason was just doing exercises back here. Here, Kelly. Sure enough. Don't work without them batteries, does it? But when you got skin in the game, but you cut me off. All right. Here we go. Mercy. Whoa. That ain't going to work. I'm going to be dangerous with that thing right there. But this church matters to me. If this church was no more, I guarantee you, I'd be very upset, very distraught. Matters to me. What that means is, Brother Gene, is that everybody in this church matters to me. Being invested. You start to look at the scriptures and see what the Bible says in Acts in chapter number 20. I guess we're just getting warmed up, ain't we? All right. In Acts chapter number 20, if you're going there with me, if you're there with me this morning, say amen. Good to have you. Boy, we are live now. When I hear myself, I know I'm going. But the Bible says in verse number 16, look at it with me. For Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus because he would not spend the time in Asia. For he hasted, if it were possible for him, to be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost. Now, Paul, he done purposed in his heart. He had a plan. He's wanting to exercise this because he wanted to be at Jerusalem at the time of Pentecost. Very important to him. It says, from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. When they were come to him, he said unto them, ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons. He said, look, you know our history together. You know what I've done. You know the things that you know, the ups and the downs. You know it all. Serving the Lord with all humility of mind, with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, meaning I gave my all. I didn't sit there and try to make I did not hold back none at all. I put it all in there. But have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnessed in every city, saying that bonds and affliction abide me. Meaning, y'all know, look, I went through some things. I endured some things. I got some scars in my life.
Some things that I've endured, and I've had to go bound, and I've been afflicted, and these things came upon me, but none of these things moved me. Neither count I myself dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. It's almost a sad passage of scripture because he's saying his goodbyes, Brother Carl. Oh, he's telling him, I'm not going to see any of you anymore. I know my journey that I'm taking, and we're about ready to part ways here, he's saying. He says, wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. He says, I've done right by all of you. You know that. I know that. We've had a good relationship. As I put the time in, he says, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. I preached every. I didn't shy away from anything. Some of those scriptures right there, it gets a little tough, gets a little hard. You know that deal about how man ought to stay out of sin, that deal about how husbands and wives ought to be, that deal about, he said, look, I didn't shy away from none of that stuff. I preached the whole counsel of God to you. I gave every bit of it to you. Verse 28, the key verse, look at it with me. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God with which he hath purchased with his own blood. Let's pray. Lord, as we bow before you, as we come to the throne, thank you. Thank you for what you've given. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you're going to do. I pray, Lord, you'll meet with us here today in a big way. Give us your word. And let that word just fill each and every heart. If there's one here that doesn't know you, I pray that they'll come to know you today before it's everlasting too late. But I pray, Lord, as we go forward, seeking your face in all these matters, we praise you, we glorify you, we thank you for this opportunity in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Verse 16 through 19, he's talking about what he's done. It's quite obvious we know what we've done. We know what we've been through. We know what we've endured. When I start to kind of ponder that and think about that, Brother John, it's truly amazing how much ground we've accomplished in the few years that I've been here. Amen. Now, I'm going to throw this little disclaimer up right before we get into this message. Now, Brother Paul's talking about not going to see them anymore. This ain't my conclusion. Now, I'm not calling quits. So for those of you who think I'm calling quits and going to say, man, we're getting rid of him, that ain't happening. Kick that idea out. Forget about that right now. But we've come through some things, Brother Alex, already in the short period of time that I've been here that has already revealed what kind of person I am and what kind of people you are. Amen. And what Paul's talking about here, he's talking about his actions. You realize our actions are very important. How we do and what we do and the meaning by which we do these things is very important. It's real easy to look at somebody on a Sunday morning and go down the aisles and shake hands and one by one saying, hey, how you doing, brother? Good to see you. Oh, praise God. Well, when you start spending time with one another, you start putting the time in beyond Sunday mornings. You get a real feel for who's real and who's not. Amen. Let me ask you a question. How many of y'all enjoyed the other night? Did y'all look around and see all the different people that were involved in that? You're right, Brother John. It was much more than myself, amen? And I thank God. Matter of fact, I did get a phone call from my house, and I had to go out and catch the phone call. And thank God Brother Carl was right there to step up and fill in. And thank you, Brother Carl, amen? Sure enough. He said, well, what did you do? I was the doughboy. Amen. So you take that puffin stuff and throw it out the window. If you're going to get doughboy, amen. That'll be the next thing he says right there. I can see it now. Anyhow, we were involved doing things, getting done what we were doing. Now, from that, what did you learn? Well, let's look at some other events we've had around here. some other things that we've had and we've done, we went through. And Brother Gene, that tells us a lot about each other and the process. One of the things, as I was talking with Brother David the other day, as he was sitting in my office, I said, one thing I'm very thankful for, this has been the most active church that I've ever pastored. Some of y'all may not realize this, I may not understand this, but we have several people that come up here and put time in and do things, to which I'm very thankful, to which I'm very grateful. It's much more, Brother Alex, than just you and I, although you and I do have done several things up here together, amen? And in the process of that, Paul say, look, you know my actions. You know what I've been about. Matter of fact, I wouldn't give you a plug nickel for a preacher that is over here and his congregation are over here and they never intertwine or intermingle amongst each other or never do anything together. Amen. I went down to Texas years and years ago. I preached at a church candidating at it in Paris, Texas. I'll never forget it. So I walked in and I talked to them and trying to get a feel for them and try to let them know who I was and all. As I got to talking to them, I talked about how I did things with my pastor and how I interacted with my pastor and everything. And to them, it was a strange concept. But because to them, they're over here and he's over there. And they never intermingle. They never act amongst each other. You know, I wouldn't give you a plug nickel for that. Paul's talking about his actions that they've all been involved in and they've all known about. You know, it's awful hard to kind of hide yourself when you put yourself out there. Amen. Amen? It really is. And maybe, Brother Ed, that's why a lot of times they don't intermingle, because they might start seeing the flaws, the chinks in the armor, if you will. But let me ask you a very honest question this morning. Is there anybody in here perfect? Or do we all have flaws? As I read the scriptures, the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all got flaws. Except for the grace of God, there go I. Look, we've all got problems. How many of y'all have ever struggled to make bills, to make them paid? Amen. Sure enough, I know what it's like. Truck payments and car payments and house payments and phone bills and insurance and on and on and on it goes. I know. It's not as if anyone in here is any better than anybody else. Not as if anybody in here is any less than anybody else. We're all a bunch of sinners. The difference comes in, Brother Lonnie, some of us are saved by the grace of God and some have yet to be to receive Him. So the fact of the matter is, Paul is saying, look, you know my actions. You know everything about me. You know what I've went through. You know what I've endured. You know what I've been about. You know my focus, my attention. And we know those that aren't right also with God too. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 15, go there with me. Matthew 7, 15 says, beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're raving wolves. You should know them by their fruits. You should know them by their fruits. You know, it's really easy to just kind of observe and kind of look and see. We know. We know. I had a lady come to me one time, wanted me to take and put her over the teen department. The problem was, I knew her. Amen. You say, what? What do you mean, preacher? That was a problem. Because she was never faithful to the church. How can I put anybody over the teen department that never shows up regularly? I mean, can I? Could y'all put a pastor in as the pastor if he never showed up regularly? Matter of fact, if I was only here two-thirds of the month, y'all'd get rid of me pretty quick. And I couldn't blame you. God tells us to commit things to faithful people. So being faithful to the things of God speaks volumes. By their fruits, you shall know them. You see, when we have skin in the game, When we're invested into this thing, things matter to us. Things mean something to us. Amen. Let me ask you a question. What if the lights get shut off? Would that matter to you? Matters to me. Because I like to have light in here. Otherwise, Brother John, I'd be trying to get my little phone out here and try to look at my words. Come on now, amen. Hey, it's good to have what we have. But there's a cost. There's a value. There's an importance to what we have. Paul's talking here. He's talking about how he's invested. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 1, verse number 5, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes. He said, look, by our actions, you knew what kind of men we were. You knew what we did. You knew how we did that stuff. And I'm telling you, it's very important for us to know each other that way. That's why I like fellowship, Brother Joey. Because the more we fellowship, the more we get to know each other, that much the more. Amen. More than just words. Meaning, Miss Linda, what we say and saying what we mean. Living up to it. As Paul's talking here, he's talking about how they know him. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, go there with me. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse number 1. For yourselves, brethren, know our entrance in unto you, that it was not in vain. You know this. You know what we've done. But even afterward, that we had suffered before and were shamefully entreated, as ye know, at Philippi, we were bold in our God to speak unto you the gospel of God, which with much contention. For our exhortation was not of deceit, nor of uncleanliness, nor in guile. You know how we delivered. You know what we did. You know our actions. You know our motivation. But as we were allowed of God to be put in trust for the gospel, even so we speak not as pleasing men, but God, which trieth our hearts. You know, I realize, Daryl, I'm not here to please man. I'm here to please God, who tries all our hearts. God knows what we do. He knows why we do what we do. You know, as we're going through what we're going through, he says, look, for neither at any time used we flattery words, as ye know, nor a cloak of covetousness. God is our witness. Let me give it to you like this. Don't expect Brother Shane to come in here and be... I better watch myself. I'm going to not call out names. I'm going to say it like this. Ray Stevens puts it in a pretty good perspective. How many of y'all like old Ray Stevens? Boy, I do. Ray Stevens put out a song right there, Brother Buck, said, would Jesus wear a Rolex on his television show? Amen. Well, I like it. He's sitting there, he said, I was sitting there at home, and he said, here he is, he's asking me for 20 with 10,000 on his arm. Amen. He's talking about them jets and stuff, you know. He's going through that, and he's got that music playing over it, playing it up and everything. He said, would Jesus wear a Rolex on his television show, you know? Hear how they come out all slick tongue and everything. Talk about how God's going to give you all these blessings if you do this. And God's going to give you all the blessings. I got news for you. You know what God's going to do? He's going to see you through some things. He's going to help you to endure some things. But what God told me in his word, that if you're going to live for God, you're going to suffer some persecution. Amen. You know what that means? Country boy terms, you're going to get your backside kicked. Amen. That's what that means. Just because you're a believer don't give you no special pass. Matter of fact, your glory days are ahead when we get into glory, but until then, you're going to have trouble down here. Mark it down. That's the way it is. But they tell you, all these big wonderful things. You know, I remember one comes on late at night and everything, where he says, you know, you send in to him and everything, and he's going to send you this prayer water. Or you got a little piece of a prayer mat or something like that, or prayer cloth or something like that and everything. And he always marches these people up in front of there on the cameras and everything. They said, oh, when I got my prayer water and everything, all of a sudden, the next day, I got $30,000 in my mailbox. I don't know where that tap's at, but I'm going to get me some of that. Ain't no truth to that. Them guys been caught on camera lying, cheating and stealing. That's what they're doing, stealing from the people, selling them a bill of goods. Paul says, look, you've known. Y'all been with me. You've endured with me. You've witnessed. You've saw. Look, we were right and honest in everything that we did. Not selling them on no bill of goods. You've known. 2 Timothy 3, verse 10. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. That's Bible, brothers and sisters. That's Bible. You mean to tell me I'm going to go through some things? Yes. But the promise is this. You don't go through it alone. You don't go through it alone. You don't go through it helpless. You have a God that loves you, that cares for you, that will bring you through it with his hands. Say amen right there. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 12, for our rejoicing is this. The testimony of your conscience that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we have had our conversation in the world and more abundantly to you word. What is he talking about? They weren't doing things fleshly. They were doing things spiritually. Now, why does that matter? Why is that so important? Well, go back with me, verse number 20 of our text. Look what the Bible says. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house. What he's talking about is personal. He's talking about what's personal. I don't know about you, but it starts meaning something when it gets personal. Like the preacher was preaching. He's getting on that deal about alcohol. Man, he's running it down the road with the alcohol. A woman over here, she said, preacher, preacher. He's going on down, and he thought, well, he'd hone in on something else, and he got on them cigarettes, and, oh, smoking them. Oh, preacher, preacher. And then he said something about snuff. And she hollered at, oh, no, preacher, now you're meddling. Yeah. Yeah. You know why? Got personal with her. Got personal with her. Got close to home. And had no problems with stuff she didn't have no problems with, but had a big problem with what she had a problem with. And how many times we're delivering a message, and when it gets close to home, things start hitting pretty hard. Paul's talking about things of profiting, not for himself, but for you, for me. He's talking about things that he's doing for others. And I'm here to tell you, it's a very important part about the ministry when you got skin in the game, how it affects us personally. Does it matter? You're mighty right, it matters when you got skin in the game. It's a personal matter. It's a very personal matter. Look with me in some scriptures this morning about that. How personal this is. What does that mean, preacher? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and verse number 1, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. Look, what I give to you, he says in verse number 3, for I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received. how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Look, I gave you what I received. I gave you what I received. You ever given anybody something that when they got it, it didn't mean as much to them as it did to you? It was personal to you. Didn't matter to them. You know, when God gave his son, Jesus Christ, to this world, it's very personal. Because what he did, Jonathan, he gave you the most important thing he has. Very personal. But how many people of this world step over Jesus Christ and go off into eternity refusing him? It's very personal. Do you think God's invested in this thing? You might be right, he is. You think it's personal to him? Oh, yes. Question is it personal to us? The fact that I've received him, the fact that he's coming into my life, that he came into my life, the fact that he lives in my heart. Brother John, it's very personal to me. That's why I don't mind going around the countryside preaching the word. I don't mind giving up where my home was and following him and going on the path that he's taken me, Robbie. Why? Because it's very personal to me. It's a personal matter. Colossians 1, verse 26. Colossians 1, 26 says, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known that what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you in the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus, whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. Is it personal? Yeah, because it's within me. I had a fella that I led to the Lord several years back, drive 500 miles just to come and say thank you. You know what that tells me, Miss Linda? It tells me it's personal to him. It means something to him. When we got skin in this game, brothers and sisters, it's personal. It means something to us. Does it mean something to the Lord? You mighty right. He purchased this with his own blood. It means a lot to him. See, here's the thing that I've come to realize, Miss Donna. I don't have to labor this thing. I don't have to beat people up over this thing. If Christ means something to you, you'll be faithful to his house. If Christ means something to you, you don't have no problem giving to his offering plate. If Christ means something to you, you don't have no problem picking up your Bible and reading it. You don't have no problem going to your knees and praying one for another. You don't have no problem talking about who you love and who you care for when Christ means something to you. There's no problem in those areas because he means something to you. When I get around people and we start talking about the Lord, I can tell those people that like me being around, and I can tell those people that are anxious for me to go. It's no mystery. Pretty self-explanatory, amen? Start talking about, oh, preacher, I got to go. Talk to you later about it, preacher. For somebody that really wants to talk to you about the Lord, they'll get right on in there. Next thing you know, a few hours done went past, and you're like, man, where did the time go? It's what matters. It's what's important. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord to write the same thing to you. To me, indeed, it is not grievous, but to you, for you it is safe. Philippians 3:1. What's he talking about? He's warning them of some things. because he cares for them. He loves them. He wants them to watch out. He says, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of concision. For we are the circumcision which worship God in spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Look, he says, look, I run into you. Why? Because I want to warn you. I want to warn you. And to me, indeed, it's not grievous, but to you, it is safe. He wants to warn. That's why we have the word. Verse 21, look at it with me. Very, very important. Look at it with me. Verse 21. Testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, as I take my journey, I encounter all kinds. It matters to me, Brother John, the kind of people I come in contact with. You know why? Because the way I look at it, everybody needs the Lord. Everybody needs the Lord. I remember when I used to go into prison. I had to kind of be careful how I say that because my little boy said it at school one day and he thought his daddy was a big thug. Teacher laughed because she knew what he was talking about. So I used to go and do prison ministry for a number of years. But when I walked in there, every now and then I'd have a prisoner would want to come up to me and tell me what they did to get in there. Now I know me, brothers and sisters. I know me. Y'all can look at me and say, you should not be that way, preacher. I know me. I'd like to know how you are and how you would react if you found out certain things about certain people. You see, here's the thing.
One thing that God has taught me along
the way, many of you that have come to me and have shared personal things with me, and I've told you, and this is a rule of mine, she doesn't even hear about it. Amen. Because I have to maintain that level of trust. But I tell them in prison, when they would come to me and they want to tell me what got them in prison, I said, don't. I said, why? Because if I found out one was a child molester, I probably would have reacted a little differently with that person. Amen. Y'all get quiet on me. I'm being honest. I know me. I know how I might would react. See, I ain't got no white and black issue. Don't bother me none at all. I actually had a lot more of the black folks in there that liked me a whole lot better than the white folks did. That may mean I'm maybe because I got a little color in me somewhere. I don't know. So I didn't have no problem there. But I'd probably have a problem with somebody messing with a kid.
Amen.
Come on now. Amen. I know me. So they go in, they start telling them, don't tell me, don't tell me. I got something I want to tell you that's going to help you. That whatever that issue is that you have will solve that problem. What I want to share with you can change your life. That you don't have to be that kind of person anymore. And one by one as I deal with it. Thank God for that opportunity. You see, it didn't matter. He's saying to the Jew or the Greek, it didn't matter. It didn't matter. It didn't matter what their background was. Doesn't matter where they came from. They all need the Lord.
Amen.
I remember Brother Buck as we used to do bus ministry back in my day, and I'd worked the bus ministry, and a lot of times they were real good about going through the projects because them poor kids need the Lord. And amen, they do. But I got to noticing something. We were always going into the projects, going, working on the poor kids, but we stayed out of the country club community. And I asked him one day, I said, whoa. We're always going this direction on our visitation program. Why are we going over here? Well, they probably don't want it, you know. They're money people, they don't want it. That's, y'all do realize y'all are discriminating in a different way. We got to go over here to the rich, just like we can do the poor. If they don't want it, then at least they can tell us no, and we can move on. But we still need to share with them too. Paul says, "I became all things to all men, that by all means he might save some." He understood the value, the importance of going to all people. You know what I found out in the scriptures? You know, Daryl, he died for the sins of the whole world. That's everybody. And if my Lord and Savior died for the sins of the whole world, you know what that means for me? That means I'm to reach out to the whole world. That's why we have a mission program. That's why we send missionaries out. Amen. Why? Because we want the whole world to hear that Jesus is the answer. That's why we go and put time putting Bibles in, Brother Bill. Because we want the whole world to hear the message and have it before them. You see, when you got skin in the game, you start valuing these things. You start understanding the purpose and the reason of why we're here and what we're doing in the process. What Paul's talking right here is, he's talking about his investment and his time that he has spent with them. He says, you all know this. You know what I've done, and you know why I've done what I've done. So I'm going to ask you this question as we get to the end of this part of it. Does it mean something to you? I used a little saying years ago. It goes something like this. The cow and the chicken. The cow and the chicken, they show up. The hog, he's invested. Chew on that for a moment. You say, what is he talking about? Called breakfast. The cow and the chicken, they show up. The pig, he's invested. When you got skin in the game, when you're invested in this thing, it means so much the more. That means you just can't just walk away because you're connected to it. Do you think Jesus Christ is invested? Oh, yes. He purchased it with his own blood. His own blood. Not another. His own. And when he comes back, Tammy, he's going to come back himself and do what he's done. Is he invested? He's got skin in the game. Let's pray. Lord, I pray that you'll speak to our hearts here this morning. I pray if there's one here that doesn't know you, they'll come to know you before it's everlasting too late. Bring us to our knees, dear Lord. Help us. Guide us and direct us. Help us to see it the right way. In Christ's name, amen. All stand. What page, Brother John?
Page 270.
270. God spoke in your heart this morning. You come. Whatever the need is, you come.
Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that
amen.
Thou
come on, come on.
Me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. I come just as I am. Thou wilt receive.
appreciate y'all being here. Appreciate y'all listening this morning. You know, as I look across the landscape and I start thinking about this nation that I love and what's going on, that's why it hurts so much, is because I'm invested. This nation means something to me. But then I start to prioritize, and I think about it this way, and I really get down to where the rubber meets the road and what means the most to me. And that's my family. And then I start looking at who my family is. Well, I'm looking at you. And it means a lot to me. Brother John was right when he said earlier what God's doing, I'm excited about, because I know God's doing it. And how God's growing us and he's developing us. But this morning we have a couple that's stepping forward, come to be a part of us. And David and Miss Judy, we've been praying about it, been making a matter of prayer, and then they came to see me and we've been talking about things. And they decided they want to step forward this morning to join us. And they're going to do it by statement of faith. I've asked David, I asked Judy. They both profess to know the Lord. They've both been scripturally baptized. So this morning they want to come to us and join us. So David, you